Would the congregation please rise? It is so good to be with you today, to get to celebrate and remember the grieve the life of our dear friend Brad. I just want to welcome you today and thank you for being here to support the family and to support each other in our grief. A couple of notes. We're going to sing a couple of songs later. The song is going to be in the red hymnal. It's kind of cranberry colored, which is in the back of the pew in front of you. At the end of the service, we're going to sing another song. It should be kind of fun. We're going to sing Anchors Away. You should have a printout. If you don't, the ushers might be able to get you one at that time. We are gathered this day in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh,
Amen. Brad was in recovery and had been sober for 44 years, is that right? I'd like to invite a few of his family members forward to lead us in this prayer, the Serenity Prayer, that I believe he said many times. This prayer is printed in your bulletin. It's also in the little insert. We'll say it all together. Oh, please stand.
So one last time in his hands off. I want to ask everyone to join us in the Serenity Prayer. Our Father.
Well, that's the Our Father.
Serenity
to accept the things I cannot change. Courage to change the things I can. And the wisdom to know the difference.
Peace.
Amen. You can stay standing. That's okay. You can stay. Brad was baptized into God's promises and into God's grace many years ago. So today we remember Brad's baptism and also the promises we receive of God's grace and love in our own baptism. I'll read the light print in the bulletin. You can respond with the bold. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you.
We praise you.
Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you.
We worship you.
To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all.
And also with you.
Please be seated.
Thank you. This is a reading from Psalm 1. Oh. Sorry, buddy, I didn't. Good job. This is a reading from Psalm 139. Lord, you have seen what is in my heart. You know all about me. You know when I sit down and when I get up. You know what I'm thinking, even though you are far away. You know when I go out to work and when I come back home. You know exactly how I live. Lord, even before I speak a word, you know all about it. You are all around me, behind me and in front of me. You hold me safe in your hand. I'm amazed at how well you know me. It's more than I can understand. How can I get away from your spirit? Where can I go to escape you? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I lie down in the deepest depth parts of the earth, you are also there. Suppose I were to rise with the sun in the east. Suppose I travel to the west where it sinks into the ocean. Your hand will always be there to guide me. Your right hand will still be holding me close. Suppose I were to say, I'm sure the darkness will hide me. The light around me will become as dark as night. Even that darkness would not be dark to you. The night would shine like the day because darkness is like light to you. You created the deepest parts of my being. You put me together inside my mother's body. How you made me is amazing and wonderful. I praise you for that. What you have done is wonderful. I know that very well. None of my bones was hidden from you when you made me inside my mother's body. That place was as dark as the deepest parts of the earth. When you were putting me together there, your eyes saw my body even before it was formed. You planned how many days I would live. You wrote down the number of them in your book before I had lived through them, or before I had lived through even one of them.
Technology. Something my father hated. All right. Check 1, 2. Hello. How's that? Can you hear me in the back? All right. I can use my warrant officer voice, too, if I need to. I'll just treat you all like my students. All right. Well, this is going to be tough. Wow. Well, it's good all week. And I knew this was going to happen. The finality of this is coming home to me, but let's see if we can get through this together. All right, I just want to say thank you, everybody, for coming here to celebrate my father's life. As many of you already know, he was one of a kind. He was a character. Many know that Dad grew up and started up around. Men don't cry, you know? Especially soldiers. But he started up in Drummond, Wisconsin, where he was born and raised. And these years impacted him greatly. And that really hit home for me a few weeks ago when I was home visiting Mom after her surgery. And some of you may or may not know that Dad was also starting his journey down those onsets of dementia issues that many of us that now I'm starting to get into that category myself are getting old and having to deal with. And he was losing his memory. And we were going to take a road trip up to a place called Silver Bay, where they have a veterans rest area up there that was what we thought was going to be in his plan if mom wasn't going to be able to come home and take care of him with her condition being in the hospital from her onset of bleeding aneurysm. So we had a lot of things coming into play there. So I told him we were going to take a trip up to the North Shore and go take a look at this place. And we started going up there. And one of my ploys was we're going to go get smoked fish at the local smokehouse up there. And we were talking, and he was not interested in going up there at all. Didn't want to broach the subject at all. So I said, okay, well, we'll head someplace different. We started coming back down I-65 there out of Two Harbors, started heading south. And I said, well, I don't want to take him home yet, because he was enjoying being outside the confines of his place up in Viewcrest. So we got down towards Duluth, and I said, well, let's just take a left and head out on Highway 2 towards the Drummond area. And he kept asking where we were going. I said, I don't know, Dad. We're just going to take a road trip. Where are we going, son? Dad, just relax. We're going to be there. All right? And if you know Dad recently, and if you still remember how he was, he loved to talk. And talk. It amazed me that I could come home and visit. And I could sit on the couch and just be quiet, and he would just talk. He would carry on a conversation. All I had to do is say, yes, Dad. I acknowledge that. Yeah, we're good. And he would just keep, and the topic would just keep going. Well, the other things with the dementia was he would ask the same questions over and over and over again. And I would answer the same questions over and over and over again. And it was just part of that process of his aging that he was going through. But a unique thing happened when we hit Barnes Crossroads. How many knows where Barnes Crossroads is there in Wisconsin? A lot of the Lees, all right? Okay, all right. We took that left off of Barnes, and it just like his memory just came back, and he was lucid, and he knew everything, and he was talking, and he was telling me all the stories. And if those who have been with Dad when we hit Pigeon Lake, anybody remember those stories? How him and his cousins would get across the lake to go to the, I think it was the Girl Scout camp, is that right? All right. Now he was telling me about other stories, like he would come, they took off, went to him and the Lee clan and the Fredericks, they took off to Ashland in some old vehicle, and they were coming home and it broke down. They wound up leaving it on the side and had to get a call and get a ride home somehow. But it just the stories just kept coming and coming and coming, like he had never forgot a thing in his life. And it was interesting to see that light switch click on when he got there, and how much that early life of him and Drummond influenced him. All right, and he wanted to always go back. Always wanted to go back. Like everybody else, we have to move away from our childhood homes and go on to other things in life, such as going to ESCO. He had to and he graduated from ESCO High School, and I know I've met through the serving line that many of you had acquaintances through that process of being in high school with him and graduating, and then him going into the Navy and executing a tour of the Navy. But it was those early years that allowed me to find one of the things that we really enjoyed together, and that was the love of the outdoors. There wasn't a place of fishing or around the water that he was not wanting to be on. He loved the water. We would go up to Kimball Lake, and I met somebody at Mom's room the other day that was talking about her and my father would not, but her father and mine would take off and go up on the Gunflint Trail, such as myself. And my primary job when we did that, I was the gopher. So I would have to go get things, and one of the things was he liked, what was it, Schlitz malt liquor, I think it was, or something like that. So I always had to go get one of those and made sure that the fishing party had one available to them all the time, and I never got to drink one. I don't understand why, but you'll see that here in a minute. Northern, you know, run around the lakes of the Northland, going after walleyes. That was a thing me and him loved to go do. And after I left to go into the service, he started going up to Canada a lot and doing a lot of the fishing trips up there. And he would tell me about those, and I would remember all those. And the thing I always remembered about fishing with Dad is I never got skunked. He did, but I never did. That was a big thing of his life, was the water. He loved the water. He would teach us how to swim. The fishing, and the many hours that we spent on the lake. And the one thing I take away from, and a saying that I pass on to everybody that I get a chance to, and it really did shape our relationship. A man can spend a whole lifetime fishing and never realize that it's a fish that he's after. And that's a pretty profound statement when you think of it. We just love to do that. What else is interesting about my father that we should celebrate? He went through sobriety after I left home and went to vocational school and then into the service. But his sobriety was very important to him. And he loved where he lived on 101 4th Street. And there wasn't a person that was a stranger to him on that street, on that corner. And I've met a lot of people that are in this room also that know him from saying, "Hey." Yes. And people would come in, and they would come in and talk to Dad. And he cultivated many, many relationships through that. Another thing him and my mom really enjoyed doing and got to be a big part of their life, and I think was one of the critical things that was a success in my father's sobriety, was being the Bulldogs' number one fan. Mom was number two. I talked to Mom about that and showed her the script that I'm reading, and she said, "No, that wasn't right. I was number one. He was number two." Hockey and sports were a big part of his life. And they would travel all over the Northland, Michigan, up to Alaska, and down to Florida, I believe. Did you take a trip down to Florida? Yeah, that's what I thought. I've heard somebody say that. He would follow hockey all over the place. I know he had a couple of buddies that he would run around with that were instigators in a lot of things they did. Denny Anderson was one that he would run around with to all these hockey tournaments and do that. And the reason why I say that is we could not plan events around some major things that happened in hockey life or his trip to Canada. And we always would have to figure out when those were so we could plan major events such as weddings, you know, graduations. I said, "Dad, the kids are graduating in May. I can't do anything about that." "Well, can they change it?" I said, "No. No, Dad." "All right, then. I'll change my fishing date." And as you can see, with the grandchildren that were up here, my sister Kristen, Jody, he loved to talk and brag about them. I would call home, and I'd want to find out how he was doing. But before he would tell me how he was doing, I would have to sit and listen to Jody is doing this and how great she's doing. Then I would have to listen to Kristen, how she was doing. And I would have to ask, well, how are you? Yeah, but Marley, she's doing all this. Yeah, but Dad, let me see how you're doing. Yeah, but I got this great-grandson that he's doing all these wonderful things, you know, and his family came first with my father all the time, and he absolutely loved and adored every one of those. He would never tell us how good we were personally to each other, but he always bragged about each of us to each other. And I'm going to leave it and close it up with this is, if you all look, there's an empty cross, which signifies something amazing. That someone, Jesus Christ, died on that cross, and it's vacant now because he surrendered all for us that we can have salvation and eternal life through him. And my Father, I am assured, made that commitment that Christ was his Lord and Savior and that he knew him personally. I had that conversation with him because I had that concern. And it was very important to me to know that his salvation was secure. And I know that Dad's light or his name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life and that he will be there forever. And that this is sad. And I did shed some tears up here for the first time. Probably won't be the last. But it's only temporary. For those who know Christ, this is only temporary. And I will see my Father again in heaven. And I thank you all for your love and support for those who... It is a great testimony to my Father that everybody sitting in this room knows him, loves him, and cherishes him. Thank you for your time.
Well, gosh, Ronald, I don't know what else to say after that. This is a reading from the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting, the creator of the ends of the earth. The Lord does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. The Lord gives power to the faint-hearted and strengthens the weak. Even youths will faint and be weary. The young will fall and be exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength in the Lord. They shall mount up wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And from the Gospel according to Matthew, the 11th chapter, Jesus says to us, "Come to me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid." Amen. I had the great privilege of knowing Brad for 3 years. And many of you, most of you, I imagine, knew him for much longer and in many different ways and many different places. I can only imagine that now your stories of time spent with him are running through your head, and your memories with him will be cherished for a long time. Here are three things that I learned about Brad these last 3 years. I certainly didn't know every part of him or in every part of life, but I want to share with you three things that I learned about him. One is that he was generous. Generous in all kinds of ways, especially generous with his time. Ron, I love that you said that he loved to talk and talk and talk, because that is incredibly true. A couple of years ago, I had an exchange student from Taiwan living with us. His name was Alex. Marlis, remember, you remember Alex. So Alex had just come over from Taiwan, and I sent him over to Brad and Marlis's house when he was still at their house to walk their dog. And he came back about, I don't know, an hour and a quarter later. And I said, Alex, you must have gone a long ways. Like, where'd you go? And he said, oh, just to the end of the street and back. And I was like, well, what are you doing? Talking. Alex didn't really speak much English, so I don't actually think it was Alex doing the talking. Brad had the gift of gab, you might say, in all the best kinds of ways, and he was a lovely gentleman for it. Brad also, I'm going to use your words, Marlis, had a wicked wit. I remember, I think the first time I visited with you guys, a couple months after I got to Carlton, we were talking for a while, trying to get to know you guys, and then at some point, Brad turned around, and I think you're doing something in the room behind, and said something to you, and I don't remember what it was, but I looked at him, and I was like, did he really just say that? And then I looked at her, and she was beaming, and gave it right back to him, of course. You guys are fun, and I really enjoy that. Brad, I know you just said this, Rob, but I just have to repeat it. Brad really loved you guys. Each one of his kids, I mean, I got the same treatment that I heard about each one of his kids before I heard anything about Brad, usually at length. And I just know that he just loved you guys so much. And that goes for his grandkids and great-grandkids, for his friends. I mean, Brad was not a young man when he died, but look at how many people are here. Brad must have been a delightful person to you too, to be so connected and so loved that so many of you are here in memory of him. So Brad was generous, generous with love and with time. Brad had a wicked wit. And there's one more thing, and that is that Brad was a man of faith. I know that Brad certainly, he didn't pretend to be better than anyone else. He certainly never looked down on anybody. Brad certainly wasn't a perfect man by any stretch of the imagination. And that's a good thing, by the way. But one of the last conversations I had with Brad when he was in the nursing home, one of the last conversations I had with him, just him and I, we probably talked more about faith that day than we had any other conversation before that. I gather that Brad, at times in his life, probably struggled to find peace in his heart. And I think that's probably partly where all the time with hockey and fishing and all the time spent with all of you came in, that Brad kind of found a little bit of peace and maybe just something to do. with hockey and fishing and sitting by the lake. I also know that Brad found peace and found rest in Jesus. One of the verses we read today, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Here are two things that I know for sure. One, Brad found some peace at last, and he found peace in Jesus. And two, I know for sure that Brad now rests at peace in the arms of Jesus. Thanks be to God, and thanks be to God for the life of our dear friend, Brad. Amen.
We are born, born.
Amen. We turn now to God in prayer. I'll invite you to respond to the words of each petition with the words, "Hear our prayer." Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church and all your people in heaven and on earth your light and your peace this day and forevermore. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith this day, O God, to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrows on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us, O God, those who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and your life. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Help us, God, in the midst of things that we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all who believe. Make us certain today that because Christ lives, we shall also live, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will ever be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. We pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us as printed in our bulletin or in any way you are comfortable. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We're going to stretch our singing muscles for a moment. All the music today, by the way, has been selected by Marlis, especially, and by the family. I invite you to rise with me and join me in singing "Morning Has Broken." It's number 556 in the red hymnal. 556. You can stay standing for this. In just a moment, we're going to do something called the commendation. The commendation is when we turn towards Bradley, and we give thanks for his life, and we give thanks for all that he meant to us. So I invite you to turn towards the front and towards Bradley's remains, and join with me in the commendation. I'll read the light print, and you can respond with the bold. Let us commend now our brother Bradley to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, merciful God, we commend your servant, Brad. We thank you. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. We thank you. Receive him into the arms of mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. We thank you. Amen. We're still going to sing one more. However, I'd like to invite you, after we finish singing, to join us for lunch. The food was specially selected by Brad for today. I'll let it be a surprise. It's good. Before we sing, I'd like to pray for food. And we do have quite a bit of food, so please do stay and eat. Allow me to pray for the food. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day, for these people, and for the food we are about to eat. Bless it to our bodies, and bless our lives to your service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now we're going to sing Anchors Away. You should have an insert, and the family is going to depart as we sing after the first verse. So they'll come.